to this week's episode of More Tech. I'm your host, Michael Armagon, and this week, of course, we have with us our co-host, Viquel.
Hello.
How you doing this week, Viquel?
I'm okay. I started to catch the cold a bit.
Yeah, that's kind of going around a bit.
I fell asleep with my window open on Tuesday and woke up Wednesday with a slightly scratchy throat. But I'm working on getting rid of this by tonight or tomorrow.
I wish you the best. I know how that can sometimes go. Okay, so, well, obviously yesterday we saw the introduction towards the, Samsung had their Unpacked event, which is always an interesting event that happens, and it's one of the most popular tech events that happen throughout the year. Mainly because that's when they decide that they're going to be launching their new smartphone products. So, sure enough, this year they launched a number of new devices, actually. We had the S10e, the S10, the S10 Plus, the S10 5G, and the S10 Fold. Sorry, the Galaxy Fold.
The Galaxy Fold.
Then we also had, the AirBuds.
Oh, the AirBuds and the watch. Yeah. One was the Galaxy the Watch, and the next one is Galaxy
Plus.
Fit.
The S10.
If I said it correctly, I think that's it.
Yeah, I think that's actually it. So, yeah, we have a number of different stuff that they decided to unleash upon us this year. So let's actually get right off into it and start talking about the key product, I guess you could say, which is the Samsung S10 line. Now this one, I actually did enjoy some of the features that they decided to bring into it. It's mainly because we're starting to see them change up some of the stuff that they've kind of been a little lazy with. Like, for example, Samsung is for the very first time actually bringing in an ultra wide camera, which is, they haven't actually done it yet, which is kind of surprising. This is after like 3 years after LG did it for their smartphone. I mean, granted, now you've got three cameras on the back of your phone, depending on which model you have, but yeah, it's...
Yeah, some with four.
Yeah. okay, so for example, the main differences between these three models are the size and some of the features, along with storage. So for example, the Galaxy S10e, which is kind of like the iPhone R or C version, I guess you could say.
Maybe the 10R?
Well, I mean, like the monkier of the R and the C being like the lower version of the brand.
Oh, the budget model.
Yes, exactly.
Budget, but still expensive.
Yeah, like even this budget model is like $700-something. this one is like, they call it flat, meaning that it doesn't have the rounded edges like you would have seen inside the S9 and whatnot. So it's a kind of like a hallmark back to what they did with the S7 and S8. Flat version. But that's a 5.8-inch display versus the S10's curved 6.1-inch and the S10 Plus's 6.4-inch. Of course, the the 5G, which is going to be released later on this year, because they're not quite ready for the 5G technology just yet, is going to be...
Cellular carriers aren't ready for the 5G technology.
You're right, and that's the sad thing. Like, they are very few and they're very sparse into where they're actually launching these 5G networks in the States. Let alone for little Caribbean or Latin America or West Indian countries like where we are.
You could barely get 4G right, yeah.
4G? You mean... Lord.
Oh, man.
But this 5G model is going to be an even bigger 6.7-inch display. And that's kind of... Like, when I first read that, I'm like, really? Like, what? What? There's only so much displays that you can actually, like, go across like that. They've already gotten rid of their quote-unquote notch. with the Infinity O punch-out that they have that's, like, in the top right-hand corner. And you're going to see it when I show you guys the videos. But, yeah, it's, like, in the top right-hand corner where it's just, like, this cutout in the screen that has, like, where the camera is. And, yeah. Then comes the RAM, which is for the S10e. It's either a 6 or 8 gig. And then the 10 has an 8 gig. Then the 10 Plus has an 8 or 12 gig. And then the 10 5G is just going to be 8. Which kind of feels a little lackluster.
It's like so much to keep up with. Because each storage different has a larger RAM. So exactly. When storage goes up, the RAM goes up.
Exactly.
Man.
Not only that, the storage space within itself is also going to be changeable. It's like a little weird. The S10e is going to be a 128 gigs or 256 gigs.
Mm-hmm.
And that's not including any of the micro SD stuff, which can go into the terabytes as well. The S10 has 128 or 512 internal. The S10 Plus has 128, 512, or 1 terabyte. That 1 terabyte is like...
If I ever have like a one, and then you can, I think, then you can insert an SD card, which is going to be another terabyte. So you can basically have a phone that's 2 terabytes. If I ever had that, I think I wouldn't purchase a phone for like the next couple of years, like at least 4 or 5 years.
Yeah. By the way, yeah, Rinkoth. So the Galaxy Fold is it's not a bendable iPhone. But it's the bendable Android from Samsung. You heard that the new phones were already going to be 5G ready. No, they're not. They're going to be, most people are going to be releasing phones later on this year that has 5G technology. Some may or may not. Oh, that was a joke. My bad. but actually, yes, while we're doing this, let me actually show you guys the pricing for this stuff. So, here we have the Samsung Galaxy S10 website, and if we want to go with that 1 terabyte version, that's going to come up to a total of $1,599. What?
Yep.
What? Yeah. Now, they do have some really nice colors, if that's, like, your thing, that you think, you know, you're going to spend almost $2,000 just, like, some nice color crap. But, yeah, no, these are expensive. And someone today actually asked me, like, why is it that these are going to be so expensive? And the only thing that really came to mind was that they're trying to work on development costs. Like there's honestly no real other reason for it other than that. And in all honesty, like when you start getting to the point where we are at with smartphones and what and how today's technology is, they are trying to find new things to actually change. Like at this point, it is a stagnant market. They're trying to make the cameras a little bit better with like AI and like, so it's more on software stuff that they're doing now because the hardware has kind of petered out. Like there's not much more that you can do with it in today's day and age. So that's, I'm thinking, where they're going to need to start spending the big bucks into software and like machine learning and AI and so on and so forth to actually start to get things to work better than they have been. And then that's where the gimmick is going to be, in a sense. Yeah, essentially, it's the cost of a new PC and not even a top-of-the-line PC. You got it. You got it exactly right. So, yeah. Then we actually start to take a look at the cameras. And like we mentioned, you know, there's... Some have a... a two camera setup. Some have a four camera setup, and of course in between. So for example, the Galaxy S10e has the main camera, which is a dual pixel 12 megapixel camera, which is a I forget the exact phrasing for it, but it has different apertures. It's variable aperture inside the in the main camera. And then you've got the ultra-wide camera along with it in the back, which is a 16-megapixel camera. Then for the S10 regular, I guess you could say, it's the same cameras plus a telephoto camera, which is a 12-megapixel camera. Then with the S10 Plus, it's the same thing. And then with the S10 5G, we're going to notice that they're going to be adding in a high quality VGA depth sensing camera. I'm guessing to help with the blurring and bokeh and maybe some 3D stuff. I'm not 100% sure on that one. We'll probably have to find out some more later on in the year.
It's a camera that most persons won't use.
Yes, it's going to be a gimmick, more than likely. It more than likely will. It'll be probably very similar to what the original Evo did with like the whole 3D depth sensors kind of stuff, which some people use, but most people didn't. Yeah.
I barely use portrait mode on my phone.
See, I use portrait mode because it blurs out the background and makes things a bit more dynamic. iPhone's portrait mode, that does a lot more like darkening the background and studio lighting and everything like that. I don't need that.
Yeah, they have like a bunch of different extra stuff, but I don't even use like the regular one. I think I've used it about maybe once or twice since I've had the phone, and then that's it.
That's interesting. I've actually used mine quite a bit. Especially since, well, actually they both have it where you can use it in the back and the front nowadays. Not just the back. So
yeah, I don't use the front one either. But then again, I rarely take selfies, so I can also use it as well.
Yeah, even with portrait mode, like I mainly am using the back camera.
But, yeah, the two times I've used it, I've used the back camera.
Exactly. Apparently, the front-facing camera is also going to be having that second one for the S10 Plus. It's going to have an 8-megapixel one. And the S10 5G is going to have a high-quality VGA one, which is, not the best. But that one is going to be another depth-sensing one. So you never know. It might actually have some kind of use, you know. Of course, with the phones having bigger screens, they are variable battery sizes. I don't know where I was going with that one. Variable battery sizes from 3,100 milliamps to 4,500. And, I mean, overall, the phones themselves seem like they're going to be worthwhile. Like, the price may be high. And don't get me wrong, the price is really, really freaking high for any of these in the States.
The S10e actually isn't that. I expected the price for the S10 to be more than what it is now, but the S10e price isn't half bad.
But you also have to remember, just like what, 3-4 years ago, the price of a flagship phone was the price cheap. of this budget version of this flagship.
And I expected their prices to be higher than what it is now. So that should say something.
That's true. That is true. I mean,
I'm over this era where like smartphones need to cost. $1,000 an hour.
You and me both.
Because let's not talk about the price for that fold phone.
Oh. Oh, Lord. That one's going to be painful.
They were so confident when they introduced it and said the price. It's just, they're like, what? This isn't a comfortable price for a phone?
Yeah.
Well, phone and tablet.
It's a weird thing. Like, I'm seeing because I'm in a group and
you're gonna call it the tab phone.
Say the tab phone. It's very similar to like the hybrids that happened. What was it? Like when your laptop being able to turn from a tablet to a laptop. Like those hybrid kind
of
stuff.
Yeah, it's like one of those. I'm waiting to see if it's gonna catch on and like other persons are gonna start doing it, or will Samsung eventually like push it on the back burner until like later on in the future.
That's actually a good question.
Like, I'm just gonna like sit there like where like the 2-in-1 laptops are sitting now.
Honestly, I'm not 100% sure. Like it's in a very odd place. But before we get too much into that, let me just show everyone essentially what this the S10 is going to be like, and then I'll show them the fold and we can continue on from there.
Okay.
So,
has arrived.
S10. This here is the S10. Introduce cinematic infinity display now, for the first there are some really, really nice parts to this.
Made possible only by our unique laser cutting.
So this right here is where they're talking about the the Infinity O, where they pretty much punched out from the screen. And those are showing like the pixels for the screen, so it's not like obtrusive into your viewing experience. But I mean, if you take a look like that, that's a pretty big, like, you don't want to call that a notch, but that is not an O. That's like an oval. Not even an O. Well, that's a pretty big notch for not calling it a notch. Like, you guys could have shifted that up maybe and then just like, I don't know, go back to like a few years ago and just like cut off the screen after a little bit. Like, so the camera's up on top. Like, I don't really get this whole Infinity O. You know what? It's just like what you guys said in the chat, especially what you said. You're done with this like era. In smartphones, I am done with this era in notches and O's and teardrops and this whole thing.
Though the teardrop is the best one.
Out of all of them, if I had to pick one, yes, the teardrop is the best. Like, even comparable to this. This one's jarring to me. Like, it has a weird fascination, but I don't like it. So it's weird. But let me continue on with this.
Plus viewing experience on a smartphone, all while drastically reducing harmful blue light to make even the brightest of scenes.
One thing I did like is that they did do something with blue light, like especially since that's been like a topic that's been put into the mainstream over the past year or so since the last device came out, where, you know, computer screens, laptops, smartphones, TVs, all that give off blue light, which harms your eyes. This essentially is almost like a filter that's built in that helps reduce it by up to, they have 42%. So that's pretty nice as well.
Eyes. We revolutionized screen technology.
Then they've finally built in with the ultrasonic built into the screen fingerprint sensor, which is interesting because there's been some that's been out there before, and I think this is actually the first Qualcomm based phone that's using this technology. And this one's actually using a 3D sensing, so it's kind of going similar to what Apple does, where they actually go into the peaks and valleys of your fingerprint because there are like ups and downs inside of there.
That's really nice though.
Yeah.
I'm waiting for VTC to get them in store so I can so I can get a hands on.
You and me both.
Purchase it and use it.
You and me both. I'm hoping someone lets me test it. Hoping.
It reads the peaks and troughs of your finger's unique characteristics for next generation vault-like security. Simply tap the screen and S10 instantly launches.
I'm not sure how I feel about this whole one UI thing where you like unlock it and it comes into like your albums or the phone or whatnot. Like, I just want to go straight into my phone.
S10 redesigns the mobile camera with 5 pro-grade cameras that let you shoot like a pro without being a pro. Powered by our revolutionary NPU, 3 rear cameras mean you can shoot with not
now,
just
this is actually wide lenses, this is actually
in
interesting.
Epic,
like
ultra wide.
This allows you
all
to really
intelligently analyzing what you
take
see,
some really nice photos from what I've seen so far.
To the subject. Its revolutionary front camera captures in UHD for new levels of video recording. And for the first time ever in mobile, S10 enables you to record professional-grade HDR 10 Plus video, resulting in even greater colors and contrast, frame by frame. While Super Steady lets you shoot high-motion video without the motion sickness, so now every shot is worth sharing.
Except that last feature has actually been in every flagship phone, well, Samsung phone for like the past 3 years.
They've probably improved on it and made it steadier. Yeah.
Sure.
Next generation performance is designed especially for how today's generation will live tomorrow. Always one step ahead.
So up to 29% faster CPU.
Preloads your favorite apps. Even the heaviest of apps open in an instant, so they won't slow you down. And because the day doesn't finish until you do, S10's battery lasts all day. Thanks to groundbreaking intelligent battery management, S10 automatically manages your battery power, so you don't have to. We're also introducing revolutionary wireless power share, giving you for the first time the power to share.
Okay, so my thing on this whole power sharing thing is, we've been able to do this for years, just connecting it phone to phone, and I don't think I've really seen anyone ever do it, period.
Like, but it's a nice feature to have. It's better to have than to, it's better to have it and have the option to do it than to not have it and don't have the option to do it.
But if no one's doing it, period, then what's the point? It's a useless thing.
It may come in handy. You see, you could charge your Galaxy Watch with it. I think you should be able to charge the little pods with it as well.
Yeah, you can. And I think they actually that off in the video. Like, I think that's actually, there it is with the Apple Watch and the pods and
You may be out one day and you forgot to charge your pods case and your battery died and you don't have no cable, so you just like store it on your phone. And boom.
I mean, if they're saying it's going to be a 24-hour battery, which I highly doubt, it also seems like it's going to be some with their intelligent management. It more than likely seems like they're going to be throttling down stuff just to try and save battery life. So it's going to be interesting to see like when people actually like start doing some serious tests on these. Yeah, there have been hands-on like tests and, well, articles and videos and stuff like that, but I want to see the tests and I want people digging into the code to actually really see what's going on with this intelligent management.
If they're like me, I barely charge my AirPods case and sometimes I forget to charge it, so I feel like they're going to eventually forget to charge their case one day and they're going to need that little power back in the back of their phone to recharge them.
They actually just might. So,
learning your habits to automatically.
I know a few people who use Bixby, but it's not that popular, especially since a lot of the features don't necessarily work over on this side of the world.
I feel like Alexa and Google are more popular. I think those two are the big dog when it comes down to AI.
I have to agree. Like, Apple, Google, Alexa. Like, those are the top ones. Bixby is kind of still petering along somewhere. Apple still needs to get a little bit better, but definitely Google and Alexa, those are...
Yeah,
Yeah. That's it. Those are the top
Google
ones.
Google, Alexa, then Apple, and Bixby.
Yeah, exactly. And then they talk about this new Wi-Fi protocol, which we're going to probably talk about in next week's episode. Wi-Fi 6.
Because we've pioneered next generation
content. And then, of course, they're talking about the 5G, which is not in this phone right now.
Super fast 5G, ensuring you're always connected, wherever, whenever. From its next generation smart screen to wireless power share.
These colors are really nice. Galaxy S10
they are. Like no other. They really, really are.
Not to stand out. The presentation was just gorgeous. Galaxy S10. Man.
The next generation Galaxy has arrived.
So that was the S10 and the E and pretty much all of that wrapped into that, which, you know, we've already shown you the price. We've already talked specs. From what I've heard so far, it is a phone that is worth recommending so far for the 2019 phone range. Remember, though, this is only the second month in the year. There are many phones that are going to be coming out. Obviously, the 5G version of the phone is not coming out until much later on this year. And it's going to cost, if I remember correctly, about $1,069 or somewhere up in there. So, yeah, that's going to be a big boy on your bank account. The bigger boy to your bank account is going to be this phone that we're about to show you. The Galaxy Fold.
Come with.
Now, I have to admit, I love the music that they actually did with this.
In a world of your imagination, take a look, and you'll see into your imagination.
People were hoping this would not be a boxy phone, and while it certainly does have aspects of, like, the BlackBerry Pearls and, like, some of those... Like the pearls and, well, I already said pearls, but like some of those boxed. Yeah, exactly. But this, it's not quite it. Now, I'll admit, the front part of the phone is weird. In that, you know, it's just kind of like a, I probably wouldn't use it all that much.
It's kind of like more like a widget screen.
Yeah.
Than an actual screen.
Exactly. So I'd probably find myself using it in this form more than anything else as a full-on tablet rather than a smartphone.
This camera's in the corner, though.
Yeah, like that is a notch right there.
It looked
that's
like,
the
it
side
looked
notch.
Like if you cut it down, if you cut the phone in half, it would look like a folder icon.
But, I mean, that's not the only place that it's there. Like, if you... Let's see if I could find it exactly. It's somewhere up in here.
Maybe. With a spin, begin.
Right up in here. It's going to pretty much have a little
with a spin
weird thing. But, I mean, it... Let's really take a look at that. That is small. That is like...
Very.
What am I supposed to do with that?
It's going to be odd to text on it, especially if you're like a two-hand texter and your hands are large. So I feel like most persons are going to end up using it in tablet form.
Exactly.
Which would then make this more of a tablet with phone's features than it being a phone with a tablet.
Exactly.
Or with a tablet screen.
So this is, I don't know, guys. This is more of a tablet to me than anything. It's a beautiful display. Don't get me wrong, and it's good for like just making phone calls and like basic stuff. But if we take a look actually at this, this is not much. This is just like what Vicky said. This is like a widget. This is like if you just like scanned something using Bixby and it's telling you what it is. And that's probably what this actually is right here. It's telling you like, oh, well, I saw this out in the real world and this is where you can buy it and so on and so forth. but I don't know. And then we see this up at the top here, which makes it look like a browser. Like, it reminds me of Google Chrome. I'm not gonna lie. Or, like, an old version of Opera. With the tab system up on the top there. Now, I do like that it has, like, the, oh, there it is right there.
That's a large notch.
That is a huge notch.
People used to be running complaining about, like, foreheads and chins, but this has a huge forehead and chin.
It really, really does. But I do like the multitasking element in it, which has been something Samsung's been really good at over the years, to the point where even Google themselves have started to take from that and actually work with Samsung to do multitasking properly. So this is actually interesting. Now, I'm just kind of curious as to how app developers really work with this to make sure that their apps work with this phone and, like, changing sizes and everything like that properly. I know most of them can be done, just simply because of, like, side projects like the Jide OS and tablet that had something similar. But some apps did not work well in this kind of format. They could not be scaled down or anything like that. So it'll be interesting to see what happens with that. But let's get back to this video. So we get back to the notch. This traffic light system of a camera system following the iPhone, in a sense. Kind of weird. And of course, they're going to show you playing games, Asphalt Legends 9. Yeah, so I want to show you guys if I can. Dang it. Where is it? Simply look around. Yeah, this right here. So this is going to be like the spine of the phone, in a sense. This is the side of the phone when you have it closed, and when you open it up, the edges here, well, the edges on both sides of it are actually going to kind of cover up over it, so it seems, to give it that flat surface. But yeah, that is the Samsung Galaxy Fold. For, drumroll please, the price of $1,980, starting from $1,980.
Plus tax.
Yep. And if you're shipping it to the Bahamas, duty and VAT. Oh yeah, that's going to be lovely.
An expensive phone.
You're probably going to be, actually, let's see, because $1,980 plus, it's 12% for VAT. Actually, it's 35%, is it 35 or 45% for phones?
That's a lot. Whoa.
Let's go with the cheapest amount of 35%, because I don't remember which one it is. So that's already bringing the phone up to $2,673. And then we add 12% VAT onto that, and we're looking at $2,993.76 for a phone.
You know, one guy in my group, like when I told him the price, he's like, oh, okay, so $2,000 came in. And I was like, yeah, basically.
Pretty much.
I'm waiting to see if BTC is going to bring this in.
Probably not.
Do, how much are they going to price it at?
If I was the product management person, I would not bring this in. I would not. No. I would allow for a special order to be made. And if you want to order it,
then yeah, we'll bring it in. Yeah, I would allow for just be on display. And if you like it to order, then yeah, I would do the same thing as you.
Yeah.
Get one for display for persons to get a feel of it and have like a sign of cheat at the cashier or whatever, like to the cashier, and you have to make a down payment before I order this phone for you.
Exactly. Like, pretty much $3,000. Nah, I'm not going to joke around with that. Like, that is a whopper of a... I mean, I could buy a tablet. I can buy an iPad Pro for cheaper than that. With everything kitted out. I can buy a laptop that's like top of the line and it costs cheaper than that. What? Like, this can only be for research and development purposes. Yeah. And I'm sorry, like I see this kind of going the way of like the modular phones like Project Ara or like the really gimmicky phones that they started something but never quite took off. And I mean, even take a look at the hybrid laptop tablet systems. That hasn't really taken off either. Like, there are a few still lingering about out there. But they're not the phone. They're not the stuff people are really going for, unless it's like a Surface Book Pro or like an iPad Pro or something like that, which is still technically a tablet.
My dad has a hybrid laptop tablet, and he never uses the tablet mode. We always use it in laptop mode.
See, there you go. So he's not really even using it as a hybrid. He's just using it for one thing in particular, and that's kind of defeating the purpose of something like this. Because yeah, like you and I both said, people are probably going to end up using that phone just as a tablet. Like, it doesn't make sense as a phone. It's great that you have a foldable phone and like you can show off the flexibility, but maybe get back to me when we can roll the stuff up and like throw it in our little like just a little cylindrical cartridge that we can press a button and poof, just like what you showed us like years ago. And then it can retract back into it and we can go on. Like, that's the kind of stuff we're interested in. This is, I don't know. I feel underwhelmed. I don't feel whelmed.
I kind of felt underwhelmed for most of the parts that they revealed, but I also think it's because leakers, and I saw the leaks from, well, I saw the leaks for like the S10, man, is these names confusing. Everybody saw the leaks for the S10 from like last year. Then the product image that they showed for the Fold leaked this week. Then the whole, I think they had like a commercial and all, the commercial for the yep. the S10 leaked this yep. week as well. So like by them doing all of those, it's kind of like, oh, we kind of already know everything. But the presentation was really nice, and I do commend them for that.
Their presentations are always, like, for the past like 3 years have been top notch.
It was gorgeous. And like how they had like the plus shape and like the images like sliding up, it made it look like the presenter was basically walking on the images.
Exactly. Like, I've been trying to find out, I think it's actually like they're using specialized LED panels and stuff like that to kind of, so they're essentially walking on LED, but I think that's kind of how they're working it. I'm still trying to figure out exactly what it is.
And they had like the balloons and the balls in the ceiling, but kind of acted like light up balloons, and like they would put everything up. It really was great. It was really amazing.
They do a really good job. A really, really good job.
Mm-hmm.
But like we said, they didn't just announce phones. They did talk about some other projects, well, products as well. Like the new watch that they brought out, which honestly, like, Android watches and Tizen watches, which is the system that Samsung uses for their watches, still are a little underwhelming to me. Like, I don't know.
I want them to kick off, so I really want them to kick off so other companies can have a well-established ecosystem instead of just Apple, but it doesn't look like it's really kicking off that well.
It doesn't.
And same thing with the Samsung, what are they called? Samsung Buds?
Yeah,
same thing with those. They still have the headphone jack.
Galaxy Buds.
Yeah, Galaxy Buds. They still have the headphone jack in their phone. And with the Galaxy Buds, are you still having the headphone jack and there isn't really like any hype surrounding the product, then you need like some type of incentive for persons to purchase the AirPods. So with Apple, they got rid of the headphone jack, released the wireless wireless AirBuds. So they kind of like gave people incentive to purchase these devices. Just so happened that after like they did that, the AirPods eventually got like really popular and really hyped up. So they, like, more persons just like automatically bought them, even if they had a headphone jack or not. Like, should I even saw like an Android user or a Samsung user with AirPods in his ear?
I mean, that's one way to think about it.
I want to see how like they kick off, and I really do want their ecosystem to thrive. But wearables, no. Accessories like home appliances and so on, maybe yes, but wearables, I don't think so.
Yeah, even when it comes to the Samsung watch and stuff like that, if I remember correctly, it even if they were to try and work towards building an ecosystem, the fact is that they're using a different operating system, so it doesn't even really use the same OS as Android apps. Well, Android Watch. So it still can't even really be the proper ecosystem. So it's still a little weird.
It'd be in the Samsung ecosystem, which they officially called it Samsung Galaxy. I hope you guys heard that at the presentation for those that watched it. They called it Samsung Galaxy. So that is what the ecosystem is called.
Let me actually show you guys what this watch is all about. Let's switch back to here.
The fit is really nice, though. I would
introducing
the fit.
Next generation.
If
yeah,
it was a watch,
if I had a Samsung device.
The fit's actually pretty good, but they're swapping it out for the Active, so it's kind of.
Is just capture data, but we've devised a watch that doesn't just collect information, it's smart enough to interpret it.
Nice.
We developed sophisticated motion sensors that scrutinize your movements.
Watch face.
It reminds you of the what?
The Hermes watch face.
Yeah, it does. It reminds me a lot of iPhone, I'll admit. Just like over on a whole. Trainer.
Watch advises you how to improve your performance and reach your goals. Watch ingeniously detects when you're active and when you're not. We designed it to keep track of your stress levels so you can reset whenever you need to.
Stress?
And it's configured to combine seamlessly with the Samsung Health app. So you can manage your fitness.
That was very iPhone-like. Oh, Apple Watch-like.
And monitor the REM quality of your sleep.
Especially that.
In a truly revolutionary move, we've introduced wireless power share, which
of course
will charge
this part
right
up
from the Galaxy S10. All you have to do is choose a strap, pick a face, and let Watch Active go to work. Next generation Galaxy
this
watch
faces as well.
The smartwatch that gives you smart advice.
So I do have to give it to them. And if I remember correctly, they also had the AirBuds one. Here we go.
Introducing next generation wireless Galaxy Buds.
There was Buds a moment in this keynote you came out to me. The Samsung Galaxy Buds was an AirPods. It's because the in the middle of the presentation, I think it was when they showed it on the big plus.
Mm-hmm.
I'm going to call it the plus. Because it was on a white background, when they rest the mock-up onto the white background, it made it seem as like it had the extended piece. It made it seem like it had like this part on it.
Yeah.
So, yeah.
I mean, the whole thing does look very Apple-ish. I'm not going to lie. It's just the AirBud design. Like, once you see the actual AirBuds, it doesn't. But, I mean, when you take a look at
this case,
like, this looks like almost... I mean, it's not as tall as the Apple case.
Just change that blue on the inside to white, and yeah.
Exactly.
Buds. Buds shouldn't only be about great listening. We've devised buds that are also great for talking. Finally, you can hear and be heard. Innovative adaptive dual microphone technology senses noise levels around you. An outer mic for when it's
quiet. So essentially,
noise
canceling
dynamically with an
built inside the AirBud
that picks up your voice internally when it's noisy.
Yeah.
We designed buds to sync with your Galaxy devices right out of the box. They've also been shaped not only to fit comfortably in your ear, but designed ergonomically to stay there.
Diversity.
By tapping and holding, you can simply let the outside world back in without taking them out. Meanwhile, AKG's pure studio sound will drop you into the front row, even when...
Just a side note, AKG is a company that's owned by Samsung. They do their sound stuff with them.
You're not there. And in a truly revolutionary move,
here we go with the revolutionary again.
Wireless power share, so you can charge your buds right from your Galaxy S10.
Killing that 24-hour battery.
Next generation wireless Galaxy Buds. Not just great for listening, great for talking.
But
yeah, guys, that's essentially what was talked about at Samsung's key event yesterday. And, you know, some of the stuff was really good. Some of it didn't really seem like much of a change. I'm mainly looking at the watch here. Though there were some nice, like, tweaks. So, I don't know. Maybe. I'm actually wondering, like, just looking at it, if it's actually still running Tizen. Because if so, they've really polished Tizen up. I'll have to take a look into that. But, anyway, guys. Actually, Vicky, is there anything that we have been missing in our coverage so far?
I think we pretty much covered everything. They have the Galaxy Fit, which is just like the watch, but it's kind of like a Fitbit for persons who just want like something really sleek and so on. I think that's just about it. Oh, and then with the Samsung Galaxy Fold, because it's at such a premium price, you now have premium packaging. So it includes, I think it actually includes the app. The Galaxy Buds.
Oh, yeah.
In the packaging. So,
the Fold, the S10 Plus, sorry, the S10 and the S10 Plus all come with it.
Oh.
Yeah.
That therefore make the price for the S10 really nice.
Mm-hmm.
If it's going to come with it.
Because that is like 100 and something, like the Air Buds are like 100 and something dollars. So
yeah, I'm guessing it's around like 160.
I think if I remember correctly, it's around like 149 or something like that.
That's even better.
Mm-hmm.
Not bad at all.
So guys, that's it for this week's episode of More Tech. If you've missed any part of this episode though, feel free to head over to our YouTube page, youtube.com/morecookies, M-O-A-R cookies. We also have a podcast. You can feel free to listen to that as well if you just want to listen to the audio version. And we also have a Discord. So if you want to actually join in and jump into the community and actually have conversations with us about tech or esports or pretty much anything, feel free to do that. And we're actually going to be back next week at 6:30 p.m. Eastern Standard Time for Esports Wrap on Tuesdays and More Tech on Thursdays. So feel free to join us back next week for any of those episodes. And until next time, guys, do take care.